Hey everyone, Mr. Happy here, and welcome to my walkthrough for E4 Savage Titan Sepulture on the Savage difficulty. This is going to be very similar to the other three walkthroughs that I did for Eden's Gate Savage. I am working on actual guides, and I know I've said that about some previous fights so far in Shadowbringers, but I've already got a lot of the work done for those, and they will be coming out, but this is just something to tide people over. A lot of people have said they've really enjoyed these kind of long-winded discussion walkthrough style videos as well, because it takes out the finality of guides. It adds a little bit more open-endedness to the strategies you're going to be seeing in this video. Now, for Titan, things are pretty interesting because there's a lot of different strategies floating around, and I really want to stress that you're probably going to see, if you watch 10 videos, you'll probably see 8 or 9 different ways of people doing the mechanics you're going to see here. So please, if you're progressing it, be open to people making suggestions and things that might make the fight easier for them, except for a few things which I think you should really do because they just make a whole lot more sense. Anyway, with the fight, it's about a 13-minute enrage, just over that. It can be anywhere from like a 13-13 enrage all the way up to like a 13-30 and even beyond that enrage. It's going to largely depend on some factors we're just not going to discuss in this video. We should probably do a discussion for it in the future. You can see the markers on the minimap here. We have A, B, C, and D, and each of them is kind of in their own quadrant and is directly in the center of that quadrant's 4 tiles. That's going to be specifically important for a phase 1 mechanic, but it will also be handy for some of the phase 2 and beyond mechanics as well. The 1 and the 2 marker, in this case, I use those specifically for placements during similar mechanic, actually, that I'm using A, B, C, and D for, but I actually like to move them a little bit closer to the center. The only reason they're here specifically is because I was using them as a reference point for our Black Mage so he could ethereal manipulate to me or to any of the other players who are going to be standing exactly on those markers. Other than that, Titan's first phase is actually probably his most difficult phase. The length of the fight being over 13 minutes means that it's a hell of an endurance encounter, and the DPS check in the earlier weeks certainly going to be tougher, especially if you're getting those shorter enrage timers that I mentioned earlier. But for the first phase, luckily, it's fairly straightforward to describe, just it can be quite chaotic to actually execute on. The start of the fight, most of the groups that I've done it with 2 different groups at this point, like to keep him kind of around where he starts, a little bit leaning to the north. The first thing you'll see here is Stone Crusher, which is the tank buster from normal mode. Now, in Savage, it actually hits 3 times back to back, and the hits actually give you physical vulnerability up. But now, fortunately, he only does Stone Crusher 3 times across the entire fight, twice in the first phase and once in the last phase. So you can just use Tank and Bones and never have to do like an actual tank swap for this either. What it actually wants you to do is to tank swap twice, where you have the first tank take the hit, then the second tank take the hit, then the original tank takes the hit again. But just forego that. Just use Tank and Bone skills on Stone Crusher, and you should never have to worry about anything else when it comes to that. Now, that's where the similarities kind of end. And now Titan's going to take a lot of his normal mode mechanics and throw a bunch of new markers over your heads and instant uses and speeding up the way he uses abilities, and it gets very chaotic very quickly. So the next thing he's going to do is Weight of the Land, which is still actually the AoEs that just get placed around the arena. You can see that right here. And you don't stand on those when they're going to explode. I mean, I shouldn't need to describe that. But at the same time, all 8 players are going to get these yellow pyramid markers over their head. Now, when a player with a yellow, when the yellow pyramid marker disappears, the square that that player is standing in will be hit by an AoE. So you need to make sure every person with a pyramid marker is in a square by themselves, because if you get hit by 2 pyramid markers, you're going to die. So we just assigned 8 people, 8 different squares to stand in for this first one. We had some people towards the center, we had some people towards the corners. As long as everyone's in a different square and can get to the next mechanic safely, that's all that really matters. So expect different groups to kind of ask, hey, can we do this slight adjustment, that slight adjustment? It's just a very flexible mechanic overall. Now, wait until you see those AoEs actually appear, those Pulse of the Land AoEs, because if you go a little bit too soon, the attack actually resolves fairly late after the marker actually disappears. So really make sure you don't leave your square too early, even though you see this next mechanic coming out at the same time. So the next mechanic is Evil Earth. Now, from normal mode, you should remember these. These are the AoEs that start in one location and then gradually pulse outward. So every time the AoE happens until it reaches the edge of the arena, it will pulse in kind of like a growing square. Now, there's 2 of these, and there's 4 different patterns that you can get where they're always going to be opposite of each other, but they can either be opposite of each other in the center of the room, or they can be on the far corners from one another. So for this exact pattern, you can see the evil Earths are right next to each other in the center, just on opposite sides. Regardless of this, this is a mechanic that I've seen so many groups handle so many different ways. The way that both the groups I ran with decided to do it is we went to a corner square that was not directly next to one of those. So in the case that those are in the corners of the room, you'd go to one of the corners that doesn't have an evil Earth anywhere near it. So once we were all in that square, we just waited and then moved in. So it's very, very quick that you have to actually get into place if you want to do this mechanic this exact way. Because you need to be stacked up for this as well because of these orange cubes, which we will talk about in a second. Apologies, I'll probably have to clear my throat quite a bit through this recording. I'm doing a lot of talking today. So I got water. I got rewind, please. My video player almost always broke too. So with that, we all just chose to go to that one. I've seen groups go to the opposite sides and make like two different stacks. I've seen people, depending on which pattern, actually move twice where they like go to the one that's, they go to like the inside corner that's next to the corner ones, and then they move outward and then they move back in. I found this to be the easiest way for both sake of healing and sake of just having a consistent positioning for everybody here. So after you dodge those evil Earths, everyone moves in. Try to keep everyone in the same square. So those orange cube markers that everyone has, the specific rule behind these is you cannot be in a square alone when you get hit by one. Now you can be in a square with someone without an orange marker, but if you're in a square by yourself, it will kill you. So don't worry about how many people are in the square, but it's easy to just have all eight people in one square. Everyone's stacked up for healing, everyone's stacked up for mitigation, and it just makes life a whole lot easier if everyone's all in the same one, for at least for this one in particular. So you can see, we take the hit here. Force of the land, we get magic vuln, so keep that in mind for later because it's going to be pretty important. We mitigate through it, we heal through it, and nothing too major. Voice of the land comes out after that, so mitigate, heal. You know the drill when it comes to just AoEs. Now, the next mechanic you get is going to be one of two Geocrush patterns. Now, Geocrush is exactly like it was from normal mode. He will jump to a position, and he will do a knockback from that position. Arms length, surecast, those things work here. If you don't have them or you don't want to use them because you're saving them for a future mechanic, though, keep in mind that the knockback is way more severe here. You should try to line yourself up in such a way that you will get knocked to the farthest point from where Titan is landing. And even then, you can still interrupt the knockback by using things like your gap closers or your movement skill. So you can kind of like interrupt the knockback, which is doable on a whole bunch of other content, but definitely a big thing to help with you here. Now, once he does that, he's going to place five orange cubes on players, and he's going to place three yellow pyramids on the party. The three yellow pyramids are always one tank, one healer, one DPS, assuming that everyone is alive, and then the five oranges will fill everyone else. You're going to want the five oranges to all go to the same square, and you're going to want each of the yellows to go to organized square. So what we did is we did the five oranges actually went to the square closest to Titan, depending on which pattern it actually does here, makes it the safest one. And then we did the next square was a DPS, the next square was the tanks, and the next square was the healer. It's kind of easier if we actually get into it. You can actually see it a little bit better. So you can see all the oranges stood directly under Titan, and you can see a line of yellow pyramid AoEs going all the way back. Now, this is going to be slightly adjusted depending on which Geocrush pattern you get, because just like normal mode, there are two different things he can follow up Geocrush with. Hopefully you were paying attention in normal mode, because I'm going to be referencing back to it a lot in this and probably the official guide. So for this pattern in particular, since it's the first pattern we got for this recording, we'll talk about Massive Landslide first. It's exactly like normal mode, but there's no cast time on Massive Landslide, no AoE markers for the aftershocks that come after, and of course, you have the orange cubes and the yellow pyramids at the same time. We stuck the orange pyramids directly under him, and then the DPS, tank, and healer yellow pyramids in a straight line for these safe zones. Now, as soon as we take the hit, we have to move out because, as you can see right there, that aftershock, if it hits you, it's gonna be a bad time. You definitely don't want that. Now, luckily, for the first part of Massive Landslide, it's fairly simple. This is probably the easier of the two possible patterns you can get for Geocrush, and it's also the longer of them, which is going to be something that'll play into effect a little bit later. Highly recommend moving Titan just one square forward from wherever he jumped to. This is going to be important for when he actually does another mechanic here in a few seconds. You can move him farther, but this is the minimum amount of movement you can make. And on top of that, in terms of DPS uptime, you can actually use this positioning to keep 100% uptime, even as a melee, until he actually jumps away. You just have to be able to recognize where he's actually going. So they move him forward one square, the tank in this case. There is a voice of the land here, so make sure that you had some healing after that initial hit from the orange and the yellow, markers. And of course, some mitigation through that. Now, Titan's going to look into one of four directions. He's either going to look north, south, east, or west. And I don't mean he's going to look directly in those directions. He's going to look towards that side of the arena. So he's going to look either to the north, to the west, to the east, or to the south. And he is going to start casting Landslide, and then he is going to jump to that location and knock everyone away in a T pattern. This is exactly the way it worked in normal mode, so you shouldn't really need me to describe this much. And you need to be able to recognize which direction he's looking, and you're going to have to go to the sides of the room that are safe. There should be four total open squares that are safe here from the Landslide. And as you can see, because of his positioning, we were able to move right into this adjacent spot. And that'll be the case regardless of where he jumps. You just have to recognize which adjacent spot it's actually going to be. Now, unlike normal mode, there's no AoE marker to let you know the Landslide. It's just about looking in the direction he's actually going to jump. Boop. And then you move out of that section, because again, aftershocks. And you don't want to get hit by the aftershocks by staying in that little section of two squares that we had there. Now, surprisingly, there are actually AoE indicators for rightward and left Landslides here. So I shouldn't need to describe this. Don't get hit by the Landslide that he does after he jumps away. But the bigger thing you'll notice is there's actually bombs dropping at the same time. These bomb boulders, which are also from normal and from the original Titan, they're going to drop into two sets. After the first set drops, a second set will drop, and this will determine where the safe areas are after you're actually done dodging these Landslides. So after whichever Landslide he does, right or left, remember that it leaves an aftershock that goes the other direction. You can see right there. As long as you move into wherever the Landslide's actually hitting, after it's actually expired, then you should be okay. Now, on top of that, we had to look for the first set of bombs and the second set of bombs. So you can see we're standing right next to this bomb. So this bomb boulder we're standing on was a part of the second set that dropped. So you can see the other five bombs explode. We're all safe, and now we can move away from the second bomb. And as long as nobody gets hit, we should be fine. So after this, the tank should try to center Titan as best as possible, because next we're going to have to do Crumbling Down. Now, it's just way more chaotic than it was in normal mode, but the premise is still roughly the same here. There's going to be massive boulders that drop down, and you're going to have to use them to line of sight and attack from Titan. Now, there's going to be two sets of two Crumbling Downs on Savage, and they're actually going to be placed at the player's locations. So there's going to be one crumbling down in the first set that targets a DPS, and one that targets either a tank or a healer. The second set, the same, one DPS, one tank or healer. We dropped the first two on the west side markers. This was the mechanic we actually placed A, B, C, and D for at the start. So because we have A in the northwest and C in the southwest, we are putting the DPS one on A and putting the tank healer one on C. Everyone else needs to get to the other side of the room, because crumbling down does still do proximity damage here. Now, on top of that, the second markers will go to B for the DPS and then D for the tanks or the healers. So basically, south side of the room belongs to tanks and healers for this, and north side of the room belongs to DPS. And you have to make sure you're trying to drop them actually next to each other like you're seeing here. You can survive doing like a cross pattern when it happens by accident, but it's certainly going to be finicky and people are probably going to screw it up and die. So the one and the two markers, we were trying to kind of use, I was using it to allow the Black Mage to ethereal manipulate to me so he didn't have to move as much. You can place them a little bit further in because there's actually some additional space where we won't die to crumbling down if we're a little bit closer to the center. And that helps with the movement for this phase, especially the part that's going to be coming up in a second here. So you take the crumbling down damage pretty high, make sure to mitigate heal through that. Shouldn't need to repeat that very much, but I do anyway. And then the second set will drop and it's more of the same. Now, in each set of two crumbling downs, which both leave behind massive boulders for you to use to line of sight the next mechanic, one of them is going to start glowing and disappear just like normal mode. Now, on top of that, if they're dropped too close to one another, they will also both start glowing and disappear, so you'll lose both of the crumbling downs from that set. Now, the big thing here is that there's going to be three lines of bomb boulders that are going to drop in columns throughout the room. There's going to be the first set in the middle, and then the second set on one of the sides, east or west, and then the third set on the other side. Your potential goal here is to try and get to the side where the third line of bombs actually drops and use the safe massive boulder on that side to line of sight the seismic wave that's going to come out from Titan. Now, that's easier said than done sometimes, because if you move too far, you commit too heavily to one side when you're actually placing these crumbling downs and trying to get farthest away from the proximity AoEs, you can end up in a situation where there's no way you're going to make it to the other side. So trying to stay close to the center four squares here is the easiest in case you need to end up running all the way to the opposite side because of where the massive boulders are placed. Unfortunately, you also can't really place them on, you can't really split the arena west and east either with the DPS tank sealers, because then there's a chance that both of the meteors or both of the massive boulders from one side of the room will both glow red, and then you don't have a choice but to try and dodge from the second set of bombs. And that's not pleasant. It is possible to dodge from the second set of bombs as opposed to the third, but it's a much tighter movement and a much tighter timing, and should really only be a last resort in case you're someone who's either A, really brave, or B, just didn't notice in time. So luckily, in this actual pull that we're using here, the third set of bombs dropped on the side of the room we were already on, so it was a nice easy movement for us to just move over to here. You can see the bombs glowing in the center. We use the rock to actually LOS the seismic wave. Then after the first set of bombs explode, we go to the center of the room. And make sure you get far enough away from the third set of bombs so you don't actually get hit. Luckily, at this point, you can just keep Titan wherever he is. There's a Voice of the Land and another Stone Crusher. And that is the last Stone Crusher until like 8 minutes from now. So you got a pretty long time before you got to worry about this specific tank buster again. So you're going to see the triple stomps right here. And then whatever Geocrush Titan didn't do in the first set, he's going to do here. So in this specific pull, the first Geocrush was Massive Landslide. So the other Geocrush from normal mode is, of course, the Tonka Truck Titan, or the All Titan Vehicle, whichever little punny reference you prefer. Now, I will say that one very important thing does change here depending on which Geocrush he actually did first. If Titan does the Massive Landslide Geocrush first, Arm's Length and Surecast will be available again here, even though you still may choose not to use it for a future mechanic, but we'll talk about that when we get there. If he did the Tonka Truck one first, you will not have Arm's Length or Surecast for this one. So you'll need to make sure you actually know how to do the knockbacks or use your gap closures and whatnot as knockback prevention. Very, very important to track where your Arm's Length and Surecast actually are at this point. So because we had the Massive Landslide first, now we get the Tonka Truck. So for the Massive Landslide, we put the orange cubes in the square directly under Titan. We need to make sure we're on the larger side of the room, the side with more space to actually dodge here, because we need to survive the knockback from the Tonka Truck fault zone like you would in normal mode. So instead, we place the orange cubes directly next to Titan on the wide side of the arena, my least favorite thing to say in this fight. And then the same line as before, DPS tank healer is what we preferred for this, just so in case we got a melee, they would have uptime. Sorry, tanks, but melee uptime matters more. I guess you could be a little flexible with it, but consistency is king. So again, fault zone is instant cast. It will knock you back. You can use knockback prevention for this if you prefer and just do the Geocrush itself properly. It really depends on what job you are and what priority you actually have in the fight, because honestly, on the second Geocrush, tanks are probably better off not using Arm's Length at all. But we'll talk about that in a little bit. It depends on the strategy. So with this, the oranges should get knocked back together. Make sure they stay in the same square together before they start running all over the place to do the next mechanics. And same with each of the yellow pyramids. They should all be in their own square because we're lining up exactly like we did for the Massive Landslide, just pushed one set of squares over, one column or row over. Now, after that, there are aftershocks. Always keep in mind the aftershocks. You need to make sure you don't run forward too quickly because he'll do fault zone like you see right here. Then the aftershock goes off, and then you can move forward. And if you move too slow, then the aftershock with where you were just standing, as you saw the one that caught the white mage right here, that'll get you. And so you can see what happens when you are just a little bit too slow, because the white mage is actually in the safe spot. This means they were just a wee bit too slow. Now, the next thing Titan's actually going to do here, we actually didn't do it in the method I would entirely recommend, but this still works. Just we were organized enough and had seen it enough to be able to adjust to this. But you see we get knocked back here. Now the next thing that Titan's actually going to do is he's going to cast Fault Line on whoever his current aggro target is. Now, keep in mind, if that target dies while he's casting Fault Line, whether it be from an aftershock or they jumped off or whatever, he'll actually forego using it and just stand still for the next mechanic, and I guarantee you people end up dying to that if it ends up happening. And I expect you'll get a few laughs out of it when you're progressing on it in the first place. So, ideally, Fault Line you want to bait to about two squares back the direction he came, because the damage is proximity based and you will probably want to use a cooldown regardless of the proximity you actually have for this. But you can see that our current tank runs over to that square and just drags him about that distance, survives just fine. I think it's the easiest if you can get him crisp in the square, because then for these yellow pyramids that come out right afterwards, you can make for very, very consistent positioning for that. Luckily, everyone here just kind of was able to YOLO it because it was kind of between two squares. We just made sure to not have two people on the same square, and that was enough for us. But the positioning there will take a little bit of practice for your tanks. You know, they have to get knocked back, then keep in mind the aftershock, then get to a proper position while popping a tank cooldown. It could be a lot to process in that like 3 or 4 second time frame when you're actually doing the fault zone into fault line. After the fault line goes out, wherever he stops, he's going to do magnitude 5.0, which is the donut AoE from normal mode, so everyone needs to get under him, and then spread out with the yellow pyramids afterwards. Again, just make sure you don't overlap, and make sure people have enough health and mitigation to actually survive the hit from the yellow pyramid. Now, again, if this was the first one you saw, you would have been doing massive landslide Geo Crush here, but regardless of which one you get first and second, after the second Geo Crush mechanic is done and he transforms back to normal, Titan will RP walk over to the north side of the arena and then do a long phase transition. There are no checkpoints in this. This is all part of one encounter. So you're going to need to be able to truck through this approximately 13 minute enrage without wiping, because otherwise you're going right back to phase one. So this, you just got to wait out. You actually have quite a bit of time here. It'll give you a little bit of time to reset cooldowns, you know, just prep whatever it is you need to. Now, I actually have my potion coming up here in about 30 seconds. The two groups that I've run with have decided that it's best to save that pot for after a future mechanic. So even if your pot comes up here, probably best not to use it right away. I'll let you know the point in which it was discussed that we should probably be popping our pots, because no matter what, you get three of them in this fight. So optimizing the timing for them is very, very important. So now you're going to be doing the remainder of the fight against Titan Maximum. And by the time you get to this point, you want to be between 68 and 70% of the boss's HP, depending on your gear. You will get the majority of your DPS in the next two phases. There's a lot of uptime to be had without this constant knockbacks and jumping around. But you still want to be at about that point. Even though you can make up for some of your DPS here in the later phases where there's less movement, it's still, you just want as much of an edge as possible. So use that as your gauge of if you're on pace for DPS. If you're at 71% or higher, probably just need to, you know, fix up the first phase, cut out any deaths, you know, improve the gear a little bit, whatever the solution needs to be. Now, as soon as Titan Maximum becomes targetable, he will start casting Earthen Fury. Unlike normal mode, this one doesn't have the dot that comes with it, but we'll have that one back later in this fight. Don't you worry about that. So Titan is auto attacking here. Even though he's not swinging his hands, you can see those orbs pulsing out of his chest. That's going to be hitting the highest aggro target. And with that, I really want to mention something important, because it's about to become super important. If a tank died in the first phase, make sure at some point they got back to top two in aggro, because that's going to be very, very important for one of the mechanics coming up here. Now, the next mechanic we're doing, however, is Earthen Fist, which is going to show Titan charging up one or both of his fists and then punching one at a time. So he can charge up the same fist twice. He can charge up one fist and the opposite fist. You just have to be ready to dodge whichever order of fists he actually uses here. So you see he charges up. He's charging up the fist on the right first and then the fist on the left second. And you can see them primed and ready to go. So he's going to punch on that side first. And while dodging way to the land, we have to make sure we get to the other side. Very simple. You'll get the hang of that one in no time at all. You just have to be looking properly at Titan to actually see it. So next we have double Earthen Fist, which is nothing like the Earthen Fist we just did. This is a knockback from that giant blue AoE right in front of Titan. You can arm's length and surecast this. And a lot of tanks will actually save arm's length for this mechanic in particular, because there is actually a double tank buster here that is a giant AoE around each tank. Now, what we did in this group in particular, and I've seen groups do this a ton of different ways, is there's a blue marker here, and this is new and we have to talk about it in a second. But what we essentially did is we stacked every non-tank on one side of the room and then gave the tanks the rest of the room. They've got as much space as humanly possible to position away from themselves, away from each other, and away from the rest of the group. You can't position away from yourself. Come on. Now, that blue marker is new to this phase and is very, very important. That blue marker will hit the square that player is in and every adjacent square with an AoE. The AoE does a bunch of damage, and it gives magic vuln up for 10 seconds. So the big thing with these blue pyramid markers is you're going to want to make sure it doesn't overlap with any attack that any nearby player might actually be having. Here, it doesn't really matter if any non-tank gets hit because you need to do some AoE healing here regardless. So for this group, we all stacked on the same side as the blue pyramid, and they went all the way to the corner. Now, by being all the way in the corner, they make it so that the corner square they're standing in gets hit, and only the three remaining squares in that quadrant are hit. Now, that's going to be the majority of the way that we do it in this video, but there are optimizations you can make that are higher DPS uptime that do involve some riskier uses of that blue pyramid marker. So be on the lookout for those, because I'm sure the community will be talking about them a lot as the weeks go on. And you will probably see party finder groups start to try and adjust to those higher DPS uptime strategies. So we all took that hit because it's not a big deal. We're not going to get hit by anything else in the next however much time. And then the two tanks you saw get hit by those AoEs there, treat those like normal tank busters, mitigation, heal afterwards, especially because there's actually another tank buster that comes right after both of those. And those AoEs hit everyone, specifically target the people who are top two on aggro. So again, if your tank died and they aren't second on aggro at this point, or if you don't have a second tank alive because they died to a mechanic, it's gonna be a bad time. So you see each of them get hit, they get dropped about 50% with their cooldowns up. I see a Sentinel, I see a Rampart. So just keep that in mind. Use cooldowns for these big hits right here, right after the double Earthen Fist goes off. Now, after that, both the tanks have to meet and get hit by this Megalith. Now, don't let that AoE marker fool you. It says it's a split damage marker, but it actually only hits two targets, and it hits both those targets really freaking hard. So it's actually not a split damage AoE, it's a split tank buster. I don't know why they decided to use that specific AoE marker for this, because that's definitely going to confuse people seeing it for the first time. But just put the tanks both in front of the boss, make sure their mitigation, if they did it properly, the mitigation they were using for the previous hit will also be up for this hit. But also give them shielding, TBNs, Divine Benisons, whatever you might have. Just treat it like a tank buster, you know? So that hits both of them, hits them both pretty hard as well. And now we're going to go into what I call the up-down phase, where it's an attack called Tectonic Uplift. So the glowing platforms here are actually going to be raised above the other non-glowing platforms. And the entire point of these Tectonic Uplift phases is to very carefully manage the blue, yellow, and orange markers that we've been talking about up to this point. So for the first part, there's going to be a Tectonic Uplift raising one of the north side platforms and one the opposite side, south side platform. There's going to be two blue pyramids, and the players with the first set of blue pyramids want to stay on the lower platforms that you're going to get and go all the way to the corners. Again, you want to make sure you're hitting as few squares as possible. While, excuse me, all of the DPS want to go to the northern raising platform, and all the other tanks and healers want to go to the southern one. So again, you're kind of splitting the arena the same way that you did in the first phase, where the DPS are entirely responsible for the northern side of the arena, and the tanks and healers are entirely responsible for the southern side of the arena. That's the easiest way to describe that split, similar to your crumbling down priorities. So after the blue markers have gone to the corners and hit the lower arenas, the lower side of the arena, they can't get hit by anything else. If they get hit by anything else, they're dead. They have 10 seconds of magic vuln. So now you're going to get a second set of markers. There's going to be one DPS and one tanker healer with a blue marker. That player will stay up top and just hit the four on the upper side with their marker. There's going to be two yellow pyramids and two orange markers. Now, on top of that, there's weight of the lands on the lower platforms. So you can see the platform right in front of us in this clip in particular. The player who had the blue marker is essentially a platform you can't use. You can't use the square that the player with the blue marker was standing in. There's also two Weight of the Land AoEs. The one behind us only has one Weight of the Land AoE plus the blue marker player. So the players with the orange cubes want to go to the side that has less available squares. So where A is marked here, if you see something that looks like that, that means orange markers go to the open square there. The other one, the two yellow pyramids, which I actually happen to have, will go down here. You can see there's only one Weight of the Land here plus the actual player. So we each have our own square. The blue marker player doesn't get hit by anything extra. The Weight of the Land's there. And the two pyramids go to opposite squares. It takes a little bit of practice to get used to, but after you've seen it a couple of times, you can usually at a glance just figure out where everyone needs to go for the entire phase. And it's actually fairly simple to execute on once you've just seen it a couple of times. After that, everybody should get as close to this pillar in the center of the room for stacking for healing, mitigation, stuff like that. Now keep in mind, if you're on the upper platforms, when Titan Maximum casts Earthen Fury here, it will drop you, and that will interrupt your casting. So if you actually want to prevent your casting being interrupted, you could drop down before Earthen Fury is actually casted, and then just, you know, go forward with the casting that you were doing before. So keep that in mind, but everyone should definitely stack up here, get close for shields, mitigation, healing, all that good stuff. And of course, you know, mitigate the Earthen Fury in any ways that you can. You see we have Temperance here. I believe we also usually use like a Tactician or a Shield Samba or something along those lines. And then everyone's grouped up for healing. Everyone's, the arena's back to the way it was, and you can do the next mechanic. So Rock Throw here is actually a mechanic that is going to jail two of your healers. And these are like the Titan jails of old. You know, it jails the healers. You got to break the jail before they die, essentially. The other thing that he does is Plate Fracture, where he's actually going to destroy portions of the arena with a very, very long-winded punch. Now, there are ACT triggers that will tell you exactly which square he is punching, but without ACT triggers, it's not too much more difficult to figure out. Whatever side his fist is on, he is going to break either the front or back four platforms on that side of the room. So he, right now, you can see the fist raising on the left side of the screen. It means he's either going to hit A or C. The healers need to be in the opposite side of wherever that punch is going. Everyone should be on the opposite side of where that punch is going. And they also, and they're going to get jailed. Their jails need to be a minimum distance apart of just about 2.5 or 3 squares. Otherwise, they get a massive damage reduction, and they become unkillable, and the fight's essentially over. Because if Titan punches a platform with a jail in it, he gets a damage buff, and you're dead. That's it. As soon as he does Earthen Fury again, you're dead. So what we did is we saw the punch. We had the healers go. You can see front, back, very close to the center line as well. Just make so it's very, very simple movement to actually execute on. And as soon as we see a platform busted, we break the jail that's immediately next to the busted side of the room. So you can see that A was broken, so we know we need to break B as quickly as possible because he's going to punch that part next. He basically homes in on the players with the jails, but he homes in on them based on which one's closest to where he just punched. So because he punched A, it's checking C and B for where he's actually going to punch next. And he sees B is the closest, so he's going to punch there next. So our goal is to break this jail. It also has an explosion timer, but honestly, that explosion should never actually get to go off. It just shouldn't, because it needs to die so much sooner than that explosion will ever go off. Now, it's the same for this third jail. He's going to now track the person who is targeted with the third jail and go to punch their platform because it's the next adjacent one. I will say that if you actually break these jails too quickly, and the player who was chosen for the jail gets to move, Titan will follow where that player was actually going to be. So I've had a situation where you see how the jailed player is on the D marker side. I had a situation where we broke that jailed player out so quickly and they moved to like the C side in this example, where Titan actually went cross country to aim at C instead of aiming at D, which we all predicted, and then we all died. So it was a funny little clip. But keep that in mind. At the very least, keep an eye on his animation so you know for certain you're standing on the right side of the arena when you actually get to this part of the fight. Break out both the jails, make sure those players don't die, stack on the final safe area of the map. And at this point, this is where groups would highly recommend saving your potion for. You're going to only get 3 tinctures, I should say, throughout the entire fight. And this exact spot of the fight lines up with 2 and 3 minute cooldown. So everyone should have everything here. and it's probably the best overall use of your tincture. Now, keep in mind, one thing I forgot to mention that I should definitely mention, because it's what a lot of groups are going to be doing, is with the distance that those jails need to be apart, it is possible to ranged LB3 both the jails and hit Titan at the same time, which if you can actually do that, if your group is arranged it and your group wants to do it, will be the best use of the limit break in terms of a potency standpoint. It breaks your healers out quicker. They can get back to DPSing Titan. It'll still hit Titan. And it just makes the entire phase a little bit cleaner to do. So keep that in mind. If you can organize it, definitely consider doing it. We actually just melee LB3'd here. We had just agreed on that. And that's the way we ended up going about it. So either way works. But it's at least worth mentioning that you can get that ranged LB3. So after that is another Earthen Fury. Damage. Like it was before. Not much to say. And Come on, Titan Maximum. Just letting the clip play out. Now you have Tumults. Room-wide damage. Mitigate it. Heal it. It's familiar. We've done this before. We've been here before, Titan. Nothing estranged here. Now we have another double Earthen Fist coming out here. You can treat the first part of this exactly like you did in the first one. You have the blue marker. You have the two tanks that are going to get hit by that tank buster. You see right here. Now, what happens afterwards, though, is different. So now he's going to do two singular Earthen Fists. It's almost confusing calling that a double Earthen Fist. And he can either punch the same side twice. He can punch, one side, then the opposite side. But the bigger thing here is that there is an evil Earth. And this will usually spawn in, one of the four inner squares that you see in the arena. And it will then, it does the usual, pulses outward. But depending on the way you have to dodge the Earthen Fists will also determine how you actually end up needing to dodge the Evil Earth, depending on where it spawns. There's easy patterns, harder patterns. This one in particular is what's considered the one of the annoying patterns. So he's punching the same side twice, and the Evil Earth is on the same side as that. There's so many different scenarios here that I can't properly show with just this one clip. But what that tells us is we can't dodge into that Evil Earth. So we know we have to go far away from it, let it pulse once, and then move in. So we let it pulse the first time. You can see it hits right there, right as Titan does his second hit. And then we all move into it safely. There are a ton of different, four different situations you can end up in there. If that Evil Earth had been on the same side as us, we could have just dodged into it. If he was doing reverse punches and it was on the opposite side to where we were starting, we could move into it there. It just takes a bit of practice to recognize, or some quick wits to recognize which pattern that Evil Earth is actually going to require you to dodge it. Just be on the ready. I'll include like charts and stuff in the official guide, but for this one, you just get to see kind of one of the more annoying examples. Not the worst one, but it's one of the more annoying ones. So, moving on into the next part, I believe we're getting another Tectonic Uplift. So this is the second and final Tectonic Uplift. You're going to get four players with orange markers. Now, luckily, again, orange markers just require that you don't stand in the square by yourself. Even if you are in that square with only players that don't have orange markers, you should be okay. I wasn't sure of that, and then I think I watched the World First video, and they had one orange square shared with a bunch of non-oranges. I was like, oh, so you can just do that. So for this, we actually broke up into two groups of four. One tank, one healer, and two DPS. I think we had that operate properly here. And you're also going to get your healers jailed in this situation again as well. So you can see the healers getting jailed right here. Now, again, the jails need to be far enough apart so that they don't get the damage reduction. And on top of that, there's also going to be yellow pyramids here, and the players in the jails will also have yellow pyramids. So they generally need to be on not only opposite raised platforms, but they also need to be far enough away. So you usually make it the two opposing corner squares that they're actually going to take. You can see our healer is on the square as far to the corner that square can go, and then the one on the other side is in a similar spot on their set of four. Now, this could be pretty finicky. If we had probably been like a step or two forward they probably would have given us damage reduction. But this puts again in range for a ranged LB3 if you want to do that. Although that gets risky because of the yellow pyramid. It's definitely something that you probably only want to do on that first set and not really here on the second set. And then on top of that, the remaining three players need to all take a square for their yellow triangles. Because both your healers are jailed, there is going to be a lot of room-wide damage here. They need to make sure that the group is healed up, that there's proper mitigation and shielding, and also consider using any personal shielding cooldowns that you may have here, any personal healing cooldowns you have. It helps a lot with dealing with this initial damage that you're going to take. Everyone's going to take the damage from all of those hits, and then you're free to do the next mechanics as you need to. It's going to be another set of mechanics very similar to the first one, where you have two sets of blue markers, and then you have some yellow, and then you have some orange markers. There's no more yellow pyramids for the rest of this. So for this first set, it's a matter of, instead of breaking it up by DPS and tank healer, you break it up based on which side of the room you're effectively responsible for. So because we're on the southern side of the room with our specific group of four, our whoever gets marked is responsible for that side of the room as well. I believe this is always, and I have Twitch chat open, so I'll be sure to refer to them. I believe this is always either both healers or both tanks for this. I've never gotten it as a DPS unless people were dead, I'm pretty sure. I, of course, refer to my Twitch chat since I have them while I'm recording this. Yeah, so it is either always both tanks or always both healers. So in this case, south healer, south tank would go to the low side that's on the south side, and the north healer or tank would go to the north side drop-down point. Yeah, times when you play a DPS and you still need to understand everything everyone else is doing when you're doing these videos. Good times. That's why I'm glad I get to do these with the Twitch chat open. They can always call me on my mistakes when it comes to this stuff. So they're going to drop down, go to the corner, like we discussed with the first phase. And now there's going to be a few way to the lands, and there's going to be some markers. And my cat is being really annoying behind me while I'm trying to record this. So now, unlike the first one, now there's one lower platform that has three way to the lands plus the square that's going to be taken up by the person who got the first blue marker. And there's going to be one lower platform that has two way to the lands and the player who had the blue marker the first time. Luckily, it's just going to be two more blue markers and two orange markers. Or I'm sorry, four orange markers. So the players who get the second set of blues, which, by the way, I'm pretty sure is opposite the tanks and healers. I think if the healers got it first, it's always the tanks second. Again, Twitch chat, be sure to check me on that because I'm just looking at it now and that seems to be making sense. Yep. So if the healers got the first set, tanks will get the second set. If tanks get the first set, healers will get the second set. So you know exactly who it is who's going to be getting the blues after you see the first set altogether. All the oranges want to drop down into the square that's actually available. There's only one square available that doesn't have a way to the land or a player who is hit by the blue marker. While the remaining players with the blue markers stay up top, go to their far corners, and make sure not to kill everyone else. Simple as that. And then everyone stacks center for Earthen Fury again because it's gonna hurt. That's not really any better way to say that. All right, here you go. Titan takes his time with his animation because he's too cool for us. Tumults again, more room wide, more healing. If you use your mitigation properly, you should have mitigation for both the Tumults and Earthen Fury. I kind of used mine a little too early there because I was trying to have it up for a later phase, and that didn't end up working out, to be honest. Now we have one last set of mechanics here. Another set of plate fractures, but with blue, yellow, and orange markers this time instead of the jails like we had last time. So look to where he's aiming his first fist. It's very simple to see where he's going to do that. And now the next place he punches is either going to be... it's going to be one of the two adjacent quadrants of the room. So in the case that he punched A, B or C is guaranteed to be his next target. And before that, though, he has a megalith, which, by the way, is physical damage, if I'm not mistaken. So things like faint actually really help for megalith. So consider using that. So tanks have to just, you know, separate, go eat that with cooldowns, standard stuff, same way he handled it last time. Now, he's aiming his second punch towards C. We can see because he's aiming towards that same side of the room. So whichever side you see his fist aiming for, you just know it's going to be one of the adjacent quadrants of the room. Now, at the same time, four players are going to get orange markers, one player is going to get a blue, and three players are going to get yellow pyramids. You essentially need to use all eight squares perfectly here to not kill anybody. So the person with the blue pyramid gets a quadrant all to themselves. They go all the way to the far corner, and everything's fine. For the orange markers, Usually the easiest way is to make the orange markers all responsible for a square, that one of the center four squares. Is usually an easy way to do that. The center for the square that's closest to the center that's not on the same side as where you're assigning your blue marker. So our blue marker is taking the entire D quadrant. So we took the entire, we took the inside track on the B quadrant for this one. And then the three yellow pyramids all went to three different ones over there. I'm not going to lie, we sort of YOLO'd that. I think we actually adjusted our strategy for that slightly, like mid-pull. Like within 10 seconds, we changed it twice. So it didn't look as, I guess it worked properly, but I don't think it looked as clean as we would have wanted it to. So watching it one more time, you can see right here, blue marker goes to the back. That happened to be our Dragoon in this case. And then all the orange markers went, yeah, that's, you could see us kind of shuffling right there. I know that we made a slight change in call there. And then our three yellow pyramids just made sure to spread out. You can, of course, discuss all of this with your group in advance. Make sure you understand exactly how everyone's going to do it, depending on which platforms actually break. You can make like a set pattern and then just rotate it based on what platforms actually break. But as long as it's communicated, it's very simple to just have all the oranges and yellows in one and the blue in the other. You just have to actually be paying attention to what you actually have. After that is an Earthen Fury to restore the arena, and now you're going to actually go into the final phase, which is arguably the simplest phase. Actually, I don't even think it's arguable. It's certainly the simplest phase. It's a lot of healing, and it's the remainder of the time you have to actually kill Titan before he enrages. He's going to start with Earthen Fury, and this Earthen Fury now has a dot attached to it, so you need to make sure it is very heavily mitigated. Try to have heal over time effects running, save personal healing cooldowns for moments like this. Case of Dancer, I have my second wind, I have my curing waltz, so I can help take care of myself while everyone's rotating around and doing this mechanic. Luckily, Filthy, the dot that it gives you, doesn't really last too long. It just lasts for like three ticks, I think, but it's still damage that has to be considered going into this phase. So after Earthen Fury, there's going to be a set of Weight of the Lands. Now, I don't think these are actually called Weight of the Lands, but I just call them that because the way they're spread out is very similar to Weight of the Land. But basically, there's going to be one that starts in each quadrant along the outside of the room, so the outer 12 squares that you have, and there's going to be one on the inside of the room, and they are going to rotate clockwise. So after it hits one square, it's going to glow for a second, and then it's going to hit the square clockwise to it within its certain parameters. So you can see the four along the outside rotating around the outside clockwise, and the one on the inside of the room is rotating clockwise along the inner four squares. So for this first set of weight of the fury of the lands, whatever these things are actually called, the tanks and the healers are going to get orange markers, and the DPS are going to get yellow pyramid markers. So the easiest thing to do is to assign quadrants to each of the four players that are going to have pyramids in this case, and then they just have to make sure they don't get hit by any of the AoEs while they're actually dodging it, and keeping as good of an uptime as they possibly can. For melee players, we actually had a melee player, and this happens later on with the tanks as well. For uptime purposes, it's okay to have a yellow pyramid that's like cheating towards the inside of their quadrant as opposed to sticking along the outside. It's a little bit less safe and requires you to communicate with your group that you're actually doing that a little bit more. Because you could see that our Dragoon is actually kind of chasing the orange markers there, so he could keep 100% uptime. He just had to make sure that he didn't chase the orange markers into where they were dodging, and he was able to keep 100% uptime with that right there. And then they resolve the same as before, yellow pyramids all in their own squares, oranges sharing squares with each other, and then it's just a bunch of damage to heal through. Just don't get hit by those little weight of the lands that are following everyone around. Now, after that, there's going to be a double Earthen Fist, and the damage comes out pretty rapidly here. There's going to be a blue marker, and there's going to be the two tank busters again. So, yes, the Titan is hitting the tanks, and the tanks are going to get the tank busters from Titan Maximum over in the back himself. So, definitely have to make sure that tanks are taken care of here. On top of that, there's a Voice of the Land, there's a blue marker, there's Tumult. It's just a lot of healing while you're trying to pump out that remaining bit of damage. So organizing those defensive cooldowns is really important. You could see that was literally like Voice of the Land to Molt's Voice of the Land right after eating the blue marker, a double tank buster, and now going into an Earthen Fury. He ain't messing around. It's just a lot of healing. It sacrifices mechanics for just a lot of damage. Now that Earthen Fury, very similar to the first one. Actually, it looks like it lasts a little bit more than three ticks. Now the difference is after the second Earthen Fury in this last phase, Now the DPS are going to be getting orange markers, and the tanks and the healers are going to be getting yellow pyramids. It's very similar to before. The safest thing to do is to assign outside quadrants for the tanks and the healers, and to have the DPS take the inside quadrants. However, if you just do it that plainly, Titan moves around a little bit more than you probably want him to. And keeping him towards the center of the room is pretty ideal here for the majority of the mechanics that actually comes out. So you saw how the Dragoon was actually following the tanks and healers in the last part. We kind of do something similar here where, you know, you can see the tank in the same square as us. They're not even the current tank. They're just going to be doing their own thing here in a second. But the tank that's actually holding the boss is also kind of hanging in the center square. He's just hanging in a different square from all the ones that we are. So you can see we're all going to rotate into where that square actually hit. The tank that was following us with the yellow pyramid is going to stay behind into the previous one. And the remaining tank who actually has the boss right now is in the one opposite to us. Now, this can be a lot to track. It's not really a lot, but it can feel like a lot because you still have to keep in mind the rotating weight of the land. You have to keep in mind making sure you don't accidentally overlap. You don't move into a square too soon, too late. But you can see all of us oranges split that. You can see the two tanks in the other center squares doing that. And then you can see the two healers along the outside just staying out of the way because it's already pretty a pretty big cluster here in the middle of the room. Then we all just make sure we dodge this last weight of the land because that was the fifth and final one. And now we get to do Earthen Fists. He's going to charge up two singular Earthen Fists. There's not going to be anything else to kind of accompany that. However, right after the double Earthen Fist, sorry, not the double, the two singular Earthen Fists come out, he's going to do the third and final Stone Crusher. You should have a tank in Vuln for this because it's been years since you had to use a tank in Vuln at this point in this fight. And then right after the third hit from the Stone Crusher goes is going to be another Megalith. So both tanks stack up, cooldowns, it's going to hurt. You can see, bam, did a lot of damage to the tanks right there, even through a TBN for one of them. And at this point, your final pot should be coming up. I'm dumb and mine's not popped right now because I'm stupid. And I also did an improv there and only got 9, but luckily I overcapped right after that. And then there's a third Earthen Fury. This is exactly the same as the first set where we had the tanks and healers on the inside and the DPS in the four quadrants with the melee actually following. Again, super simple. Don't do that. All right, there you go. See, I'm a little nervous because he was creeping up into my corner right now. I was getting a little nervous right there with the machinist. At this point, there's two more singular Earthen Fists, and at this point, it's heal and DPS check. That's all that's really left at this point. So just don't get punched in the face and get knocked off because it's going to hurt really bad at this point. And we even get another LB3 here. So if you LB3'd where the first set of jails were, you should have another LB3 by the time you get to this point. But you can see it's just a massive amount of damage that's going to be coming out here. We got Voice of the Lin. We got Tumults. We got Earthen Furies. We got all sorts of things coming out here. There's the Voice. Here's the Tumults coming out. While the Tumults are still casting, you see there's the fourth Tumult, the fifth Tumult. Here's another Voice of the Land right here. And then you're going to see Titan the back charge even more Tumults right here. You're going to see bam, smack, smack, smack. And at this point, it's just stay alive and finish the DPS check. That's all you got left. Once he goes to cast a really long cast, Earthen Fury, that is the Enrage. That is the end of the fight. And that can happen anywhere from like the 13-13 mark all the way up to like the 13-38 mark, depending on your slow versus fast instances. Again, not a topic we'll really talk about for this specific video, but it's a hell of a fight. It's actually not super mechanically difficult in a lot of ways. It's a lot of tanks, healers, and DPS will always have very set assignments with minor adjustments. And so I actually don't think this is going to be that bad of a pug nightmare outside of making sure you actually kill the boss before he kills you, before you actually get the Enrage. The first phase is going to be, I think, the one people struggle with most. I think the tectonic uplifts will probably get people for a little bit, but I don't think people should be too afraid to actually go about pugging this encounter right here. Just keep in mind you want that 68 to 70% transition going into the second phase, and you want approximately a 28 to 29% transition going into that final phase where you'll don't ever talk to me or my son again phase actually, excuse me, starts up. So there's so many different strategies for this fight. Do not take anything you saw here as the absolute way to go about doing it. Every group's going to have like small adjustments and things that they want to do slightly differently. There's going to be uptime strats that come out. And it's actually a really fascinating fight to me for that reason. It's so flexible, yet so rigid at the same time that it strikes this really interesting balance between the way groups look at it and approach it versus the way that it seems like it actually wants you to go about doing the mechanics. So hopefully this was of help to people while you're still waiting for an actual Sepulture guide to come out for me, something that will probably still be pretty long, but not as long as this, because this is like going on like close to an hour now, which is about how long I expected it to actually take. So I'd say I'm pretty much on pace. But if you have any questions, if you have any suggestions for any players, any specific roles, head to the comment section down below. I'm positive there are things that certain roles, certain jobs could do that would absolutely be helpful that are not mentioned in this video. And that's always great for people to share that kind of stuff in the comment section of the YouTube video. But anyway, I've got a few minutes left of a Twitch stream to wrap up. I'm going to get this uploaded and get working on all of the actual Eden Savage guides that we want to get done. And I will see all of you on YouTube in those guides coming this week. Trying to get those done ASAP with a text guide with tons of charts to actually accompany those to make up for my kind of poor performance on guides for the first month of the expansion. Anyway, I will see all of you on YouTube on the next video, and Twitch chat will hang out for a few more minutes before I go get lunch. So thanks everyone, and take care.